Lord Jesus Christ as we gather together to celebrate Shavuot.
Amen.
And as the Greek calls it, Pentecost.
Amen.
Very, 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 very important day in the calendar of the church. This morning I hope that you are going to see some new things and that God's going to open your eyes. So I hope that you're enjoying our freedom, because I'm so glad to be back into the house of the Lord and see your faces.
Amen.
I wish I could see all of your smiles. If everybody pick your mouth up and I can see you smiling, maybe. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we love you. We praise you. We celebrate this day. And Lord, we're expecting something wonderful to happen. Because Lord, we just believe that today you're going to anoint us afresh and anew, that your Holy Spirit's going to descend. And Lord, we're going to just stand in your presence and be anointed to do your will and your work. Holy Spirit, have the Father's way in our lives and our hearts. And we would be totally obedient to him. And we thank you for it. Yeshua's name. Amen.
Is our God.
we honor you this morning and the praises that go up. We honor your name. We honor your very being this morning with our praise. For greater you, Lord, and worthy of praise. There is no one like our God. There is no one like our God. Father, we pray this morning for our nation. We pray for our land that is crying out. The people are crying out, Lord. Help us. Deliver us. Father, that your love would permeate our hearts. That you would break up the fallow ground. That you would cleanse our minds and our bodies. That your spirit would move in our great land. A land that is hurting. A land that doesn't understand. A people who are lost. Father, we pray this morning that your spirit would bring us together. Every man, every woman, every child would be brought together under your name. Holy Spirit, that lives that have been ruined would be restored. Hearts broken would be mended. Lives that have gone in opposite directions would be turned right. Bring us back to you, Lord. Holy Spirit, bring us back to you. That our hearts, our minds, and our spirits would be on you. That your love would speak louder than any other voice on this earth. That people would be able to see who you are and what you are and your place for them in their lives. For great are you, Lord. Great are you, Lord, and worthy. So worthy. Lost to save and find their way. At the sound of your great name, all condemned feel no shame. At the sound of your great name, dead revealed has no place. At the sound of your great name, the enemy, he has to flee. At the sound of your great name, your great name. Hungry souls receive grace at the sound of your great name. Fatherless, they find their rest at the sound. Your great name. The junk that goes on in our day-to-day lives. We can't just sit here in little old Smithfield and say, it's not us, it doesn't touch us, it's not ours. Because Scripture says it is. It is ours. And our responsibility is to pray. And so we're going to go back and sing these verses again. I don't want you just to find a spot, whether it's sitting down, coming to the altar, standing up, whatever it is for you. And I want you to begin to pray for our nation. Pray for our state. Pray for our legislators. Pray for the men and women in uniform. That's the police, the firemen, the SWAT teams, all those things that are being enacted right now. Because we're headed in a direction that we don't want to be in if it continues. They're going to declare a military state, and we're going to have men in uniform with guns policing every single street. That's not what our country is.
That's right.
Our country is a country of freedom. But when we invoke danger on others, that's not the way it works. But God, God can change this. God
Amen.
Can change people's hearts. He knows where they are. If Saul can have a Damascus Road meeting with God, and he was one of the wickedest men, that God can change the hearts of the people that are doing stupid stuff. Guaranteed. And pray for those people's families. Because you know, some of the families are just lost. They're going, I don't know why they're doing this. I don't know what's going on. So we need to pray for them too. So we're going to go back and give you a time just to pray to God. Pray that He heals our land. Pray that He changes people's hearts. Pray that He change your heart. Pray that He give you a passion to pray for these people. For our nation. Give us a passion, Lord. Pray for our nation. A passion to lift people up in prayer, to see them saved. Isn't that our mission? That's what the Bible says. Go into all the world. Father, we come to You this morning and we begin praying for our nation. Father, we pray for our leaders that You would give them direction, that You would give them clarity, that You would give them the administrative things to do in our nation. But more importantly, Lord, we ask that You meet them in the midnight hour. That You touch their hearts, You touch their minds, You give them the things they need, but that their lives would be changed for You. Father, I pray for President Trump right now. I can't imagine being in a place of authority where everything just seems to be in chaos. So, Father, I ask that You bring Him peace. I ask that You bring Him clarity of mind. I ask that You meet Him where He is. Father, that Your light would shine into the darkness of Him. Father, that his life would be changed by You, that You would meet him in the midnight hour, that You would give him direction and guide him, place people around him as advisors that would help him move in the right direction, and speak to those men and women that are in those places, Lord, that their hearts would be turned toward You. Father, we pray for our nation. Father, there's a lot of hurt going on. Father, we are in desperate need of You. Our land is hard. Hearts have been hardened toward You. Lives have turned from You. Father, break up that fallow ground and turn us around. Lost or saved, they find their way at the sound of Your great name. And all condemned, they feel no shame at the sound of Your great name. And every fear has no place at the sound of Your great name. The enemy, he has to leave at the sound of Your great name. All the weak, they find their strength at the sound of Your great name. Hungry souls receive grace at the sound of Your great name. Your name, the sick You are the rock on which we stand, so that we will not falter. Great is your name. Thank you.
Oh, refreshing, refreshing, refreshing rain.
We thank you that you care so much for us. We thank you that your love is so vast, that you know the very hairs on our head. Father, we thank you that you care for the people of this land. We turn to you. Father, not just in our hour of need, but Father, we turn to you with praise and adoration because of the love you have for us and the love you have shown us. Father, we pray that that same love would just be outpoured upon our nation. That the refreshing rain of your Spirit would rain down and wash away the turmoil and chaos. Thank you, Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
We do need him. Amen. The light of Christ, where the word is preached in power and presence of the Holy Spirit is evident. Amen.
Amen.
Good to see you all here this morning. Good to see some folks back. We haven't seen in a while.
Woo!
Amen. Amen. It's a good day. Amen. Bless the Lord. Couple things I want to remind you of. As you came in, you saw that the
cones right here around the bird. She has four big eggs. So she's probably laid all she's going to lay. So please be very careful going in and out there. She gets quite upset. Yes, they're male and female. Will, yeah. Yes. Yes, they take turns going in there. So. Under the shadow of their wings. Amen. And you see that. I mean, she gets that. You know, when you think about how birds protect us, how much more the Lord protects us.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen. Well, happy Pentecost.
Amen.
Woo. I don't know about you, but I'm looking. The devil's kicking up his heels, but I'm looking for Yehovah.
Amen. And
he's going to pour out his spirit on this place. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Wednesday night Bible study. Some of y'all missed it last week. Some of us made it. So press in. Come to Bible study on Wednesday night. Thursday night, intercessory prayer. We're back to our normal, I don't want to say routine, but our normal schedule. It's a better word. All right. Also, devotionals out there. There's some. Get one. There's one. Get one per family, one per household, if you would. Also, there's the new charismas around.
Here we go.
Several good articles in here. Chuck Pearson's got a good one. Michael Brown has got a good one in there. There's several really on-time articles in this one. So get them there out there. Take some. I know that with social distancing, all those things, that offices and all have taken those things up. You have to sit in your car till they come get you. But that's not forever. So get some, pass them around, see some friends, get them to them. Amen? Amen. So also, guys, you want to put that picture up. When they were doing the camera this morning, it's kind of hard. It's kind of a rough picture, but I want you to see that how the kind of the anointing, how the wings and all this stuff kind of just jumps out at you, and that this holy glow, if you would. Amen.
Amen.
So, having said all that, what time is it?
Offering time.
What time?
Offering time.
Amen. Stand your feet. Get your offering out. Amen. Hallelujah. Hold your offering up real high and say, Yehovah.
Yehovah.
I thank you.
I thank you.
That I am favored.
That I am favored.
And because of your favor.
And because of your favor.
I am blessed.
I am blessed.
Now you know that, right?
Amen.
You know that you're a blessed people because you serve a mighty God.
Amen.
Deliver him. Keep him. Sustain him. Lord, I thank you.
Lord, I thank you.
Forgive me seed to sow.
Forgive me seed to sow.
And I'm sowing.
And I'm sowing.
By faith. In good ground.
In good ground.
Believe in you.
Believe in you.
For the increase.
For the increase.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For the overflowing. Open the window of heaven.
Open the window of heaven.
And for debt-free living.
And for debt-free living.
In Yeshua's name. Stay 6 feet away. Praise the Lord.
Unto the work that the Lord is doing in the earth. Yes, I can hear the sound of the abundance of rain in the spirit. Have you not seen and partaken with your own eyes that I have seen an abundance of rain in these days, recently, says the Spirit of the Almighty God? And have you not observed that when the rains come and the deluge comes, that it makes a way in the wilderness, that it makes a way on the dry ground, and I will even come and I will make a way where there is no way, saith the Lord. Yes, I will change times and seasons. Yes, I will change habits and patterns, saith the Lord. And suddenly on that day, there came a sound of a rushing mighty wind. And yes, it was even the Ruach of my spirit, the Holy Spirit of the Lord in that day. And have you not read and have you not heard that it was a sign of the wind? And was it not the fire? Yes, the fire of my spirit. And what do you get when you mix fire and wind, saith the Lord? It is uncontainable. It is unrestrainable. And in this day and in this hour, you will see that I am unrestrainable. Just as they have felt that the virus was unrestrainable, as they think that the violence is unrestrainable, nothing is unrestrainable by my spirit, saith the Lord. And yea, I am able to raise up prophets in this day. And yea, I am ready to speak through you. And as Moses was on the backside of the desert doing what he wanted to do, says the Lord, he was not in my spirit until he beheld and he saw the burning bush. And I say, was the burning bush restrainable? No. So the fire of my spirit is not restrainable in this day, nor in this hour, nor has it ever been, nor will it ever be. But listen to me, my children, and hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to you. When you attain the fire, my fire, and when I breathe on you, you will become a new man. the death spirit that has hovered over my church in the past will be gone and to be seen or heard from no more. But the Holy Spirit is breathing, longs to breathe life onto the dead church. And you will arise and you will do what I have commanded you to do. You will no longer be sitting down wondering, when is revival coming? What am I to do? What is my purpose in the earth? But you will know once you have been, you have seen my, you have taken in my breath, and you have beheld my fire, says the Spirit of the Lord. Then you will do my work. You are not here to do nothing. You are not here to sit. But yes, I have commanded you to walk and do and live passionately for my glory, says the Lord, and for my name. My name is above every name that is named, says the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Praise the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to Jesus.
Come on and praise Him.
Look what the Lord has done.
Look what the Lord has done. Look what the Lord has done. He healed my body, He touched my mind, He saved me, Lord, just in time. And we go on to praise His name. He saved His just the Son.
Suddenly your bills are going to be paid. Suddenly you're going to be healed. Suddenly you may have been single, you're going to get married. Suddenly things are going to take place in your life that you've been hoping for, wishing for, praying for a long, long time. The rain is coming. Get out. Don't get your umbrella out. Don't get your poncho on. Get out and get soaked in the rain of the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Ministering to me and I'm ministering to her and so forth. I believe we're breaking through to a new era starting today.
Amen.
Now, with that, it's your choice. Okay? It's your choice to be obedient or not. Totally. He's never going to take our free will. It's our choice. It's our choice to hear. It's our choice to do. And we need to understand it. But we're going to talk about Pentecost this morning, and I'm going to share some things with you that you may not have seen and heard. Some other stuff that she brought out, some of it in the word that the Lord gave her this morning. True church is stepping in, and I say the true church is stepping in for the power and the anointing of Yehovah. Now, before I start, I do want to say a couple of words about Chuck Pierce's article in Charisma, New Charisma. I hope you will all read it. I hope you will all take heed to what he's saying. He's saying some things that I've been saying over the last couple of years in here. He's just confirmed it to me. Book of Exodus. Know it, read it, stand on it, see what God's done and what God's going to do in your life.
Come on.
It's in Chuck Pierce's article. A couple of things that I want you to know that he says, that one of the things that he talks about is the name of Abraham. The name of Abraham. And the Hebrew name of Abraham, which is Aleph Bet Resh, if you look at it, if you know it, stands for crossing over. Abraham had to leave as the Ur of Chaldees, had to leave and cross over. It's time the church come out of the world and cross over into the kingdom of God. It means we got to come out of the world and cross over. Right, he talks about the number 80 in the Hebrew calendar, and he says the Hebrew word letter pay, which is the letter for 80. Pay means to breathe or have voice. And Passover, Pentecost, means to breathe and have voice. There's a new breath of God, Yehovah, coming on the church, and is on the church now.
Amen.
But you have to step into it. You have to receive it. All right? A new voice is coming. When the Hebrew people crossed out of Egypt and crossed over, it was a journey to the promised land. Church is going to start moving again, and we're going to start journeying, final journey to our promised land destination with Yehovah. Crossing out of this world into His world, the kingdom of God. Alright? Now, he goes on and he says some other stuff, and I'm not going to tell you all of it, but one of the things that he says, I want you to hear this. He says, we recall, I'm reading from his article, that when David gathered his men for war at Ziklag, the tribe of Issachar was described as those who understand the times and knew what to do. The times and the seasons. How many tribes were there?
12.
How many tribes understood what to do in the times and the seasons?
One.
God is going to tell us He's going to show us. He's going to direct us. But we've got to know the times and to see. You've got to hear the word. You've got to study the word. You've got to receive the word. You've got to do the word. And you've got to develop your relationship with Yehovah. It's all about relationship. He goes on in the last couple of sentences, or the last sentence, in that same paragraph. It says, in the same sense, this writing should help you that the Issachar anointing that is necessary to maneuver you through today's world crisis. How many times have I been telling you over the last couple of years, you need to step into the anointing of the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit is going to be the one to direct you, to guide you, to save you, and so forth. And if you're not walking in it, it's your choice. You'll not be saved. Can be destroyed. So I'm just giving you this as, and I picked it up when they laid it in my chair today and turned to this article. And I read it. And the Lord said, this is what you've been trying to tell the people at the Light of Christ for a couple of years. He's confirming what I've been telling you. So we've got to hear. Now, I want us to look. We're going to do some in-depth study. So the first thing I want you to do, I want you to take your watch. Pull it off, stick it in your pocket. And your cell phones too, unless you're using them to look up scripture. Because I can tell you, I've got a word from him, and I'm not going to be hindered to press through it. All right? Now, first thing we've got to understand is Jesus, when he came and he was resurrected, John chapter 20, I've got some of the scriptures here, let me just turn to John chapter 20. Verse 19, then the same day and evening, being the first day of the week, when the doors were shut and the disciples were assembled for the fear of the Jews, came Jesus and stood in the midst of them and said unto them, peace be unto you. Fear. We've talked about fear over the last couple of weeks and so forth. Telling you something. We don't need to fear anything except the Holy Spirit, God. Fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Fear should not control us, but it was controlling them. So Jesus said unto his disciples, peace be unto you. Shalom to you. Now if you know anything about Greek, you can know that he could have just said shalom in the third person, and it would mean shalom to you. But when he puts, when there is an adjective or when there is a pronoun, is the proper use, out there, he's making emphasis to you. To you. Peace to those who receive it. Peace to those who search it. Peace to those who know it in. In this case, is the word to you is there. Now, he goes on, and he says, he showed him his hands and his side, and the disciples were glad when they saw it was to you. In verse 20, he says, peace be to you, as my Father hath sent me, even so I send you. Even so I send you. I send you. Now this is something that the church needs to grasp a hold of. Pentecost came to send the church. First Corinthians chapter 15 tells us that there are over 500 people that saw, heard Jesus. And he said this to him, again I'm paraphrasing. He says, but tarry ye in Jerusalem until you be endued with power from on high. From Passover to Pentecost, there were 7 weeks, 7 times 7, 49 days. Pentecost was the 50th Sunday. A waiting period. Jesus was with his disciples coming and going for 40 days. It left a period of 10 days before Pentecost came. Something that the majority of the church does not know is the Jewish people and the Jewish scholars recognize Pentecost to be also the day that Moses was given the 10 commandments. I want you to get this. Because the law, we're going to look at the law. The law was given and was born. The same time of year that the church was born. Very important, you understand. Now back in John chapter 9, says Jesus breathed on them and said unto them, receive you the Holy Ghost. To me it's amazing. This time in season we celebrate the breath of God. In this pandemic, what do we fear?
The breath of humans.
The breath of man. Coincidence? Or maybe it's something that God's trying to get us to understand. We need to go back to the breath of God, because that's where life is, where hope is, where joy is, where peace is, where everything is. It's wrapped up in the breath of God. And when Jesus breathed upon his disciples, he said unto them, receive ye the Holy Ghost. Whosoever sins you remit, they are remitted unto them. And whosoever sins you retain, they are retained. All right? Greek says this, whosoever ye forgive the sins, they are forgiven of them. But whosoever ye hold, they have been held. Who's the responsibility on? Who did Christ place the responsibility to? His disciples did. In other words, their choice. Their choice. We see this when Stephen was crucified, when he said, Lord, don't lay this charge to their feet. Do you understand? What he's telling the church is we've got to be the one that's following the Father and being like Jesus and forgiving. We've got to be The one, as I tell you every Sunday, who Christ has seen in us. Your life has got to be the example of His life. Now we know that Jesus was taken up, and we know this. The disciples were not sent out because they had not received the Holy Spirit yet. And there was a waiting time. A total waiting time. In Acts chapter 1, verse 4 says this, and being assembled together, he commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. He commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem. The Greek says, in meeting with them, he charged them from Jerusalem not to depart, but to wait the promise of the Father that you heard of me. Because John truly baptized in water, but you shall be, but in the Spirit will be baptized the Holy Spirit, not after many days. He charged them. Commanding them and charging them are a little different. I give you a commandment. Stay here. I charge you. What does that say to you? I tell you, it's your responsibility. You stay here. You do not part until you receive the Holy Ghost. If you do, you're going to miss it. Not an option. It's a commandment. Do it. Now we know that at least 380 people who heard that walked away. Missed it. Now, Acts chapter 2. Right. And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were with one accord in one place. Now, I don't know what that says to you. What does it mean when the day of Pentecost was fully come? See, Sheila's right. We talked about this.
I think it was sunrise.
I've had a problem with that fully come. What do you mean? There's something here more than what it's saying to me.
I
mean, it was the day of Pentecost. Alright? Shavuot, the Hebrew says. When it was completed, it was over. What he's actually saying is all the festivals, all the rituals, and everything was done, it was over. People are just looking around. Nothing happened. Nothing going on. And then Yehovah stepped forward. I want you to see that. It's very important that we understand. understand. Now, I'm going to back up a minute because I'm going to talk just a little bit about, without turning to Leviticus 23, I'm going to talk a little bit about Shavuot. You need to understand what it is so you can really understand what's being birthed. All right? There's seven main feasts in the Hebrews. And God calls them His appointed times. They're divided and set into three. Father, Son, Holy Ghost. Seven feasts, completion. In this feast, it is, the main feast was Passover, Shavuot, and Tabernacles, or the Day of Atonement. Every Jewish man was commanded by the Scripture to be in Jerusalem on those days. Why not women? Women came with men. Man was the head of the household. If they came, then the children. It was not an option. Not an option at all. The feast of Shavuot that takes place at this time was the harvest feast of the wheat harvest. It was the harvest feast. Now, what they did, part of what they did, and I'm not going to go through it, but the high priest would take wheat and they would wave it to Yehovah. Wave it back and forth as the first fruits of the harvest. Alright? The first fruits of the harvest. What you've got to understand is this caused God's blessing to come on their harvest so they could live, eat, herds, and everything else. There's more to it, but I'm not going into it. Another part of it was the priest would take two loaves of bread. Two loaves of bread, symbolizing the bread of life. You had the fruit of the wheat that when it was beaten, cooked, and fixed, produces bread. And this was revealed to God that God was going to provide. And I want you to say, I searched and searched, and I didn't see where there was no living in these bread. Not like the Passover bread where they said it couldn't be living. I may have missed it. But this was bread representing food. But it's also two loaves. Many people believe that it represents the coming together of the Jews and the Christians into one body. Right? That's going to become important. One body. It also represented the fruit producing life. Bread. What do we have on the communion table? Bread representing His Word. What did they have on the table of showbread? Bread stacked up representing the 12 tribes. The Word. It's the Word eaten. The Word became flesh. Jesus dwelt among us. Alright? Now, and there's so much more we could go into. We're not going into that. We're going into something good. Alright. Back to Acts 2. When it was fully come, they were with one accord in one place. They were all together, together, is the way the Greek says. Translated, all together, one accord, in one place. But it meant they were all in one. Same page, same agenda. Everything was about Yehovah. Now, here's one of the keys that you need to understand. If God's going to move, we're going to have to be in accord, one accord, together. That doesn't mean stragglers out here and stragglers out there. That means the body coming together in Him, doing what He says do and He wants us to do. When they were in one accord, at the completion of the ceremony of Shavuot, there came the sound of a mighty rushing wind. A mighty rushing wind, and it filled the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like a fire, and it set on each of them. Now, if we start looking for something to try to grasp the understanding of what's taking place, we need to go back and see if we can find something in the church, in the Bible. So, I flip back to Genesis. And I'm looking at the beginning. In Genesis chapter 2, we've got something very important here. And the Lord God formed the man of the dust of the ground, Adam, we say Adam, but it's actually in the Hebrew is Adam. Formed it. What you got is you've got a body with no life in it. Here you had 120 people in an upper room that was a body, fearful, not knowing what's going to happen, behind closed doors, scared, not knowing what's going forward. You see, we can have a body, we can have a building, we can have all these things. Just like God made that body of Adam. But it was lifeless. Until Yehovah bent down and He breathed in to his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. Now, those of you that have known my teaching and been through a lot of my teaching, we basically got two. We got two creation stories. One of them, it says, we've got the creation story where God made them on the sixth day, Adam, our man, and it says He made them male and female. All right? And now we have a singular individual in chapter 2 that God created them. But He didn't come alive until God breathed the gospel, the good news. God breathed His life into them. It's the life, the Spirit of God, that brings life. So we have the breath of life going into Adam. He becomes the first man of the team. And there's a lot there we could get into. Eve and the wife and so forth. It all comes out of the relationship with God. Now what it says, on the day of Pentecost, there came the sound of a rushing mighty ruach wind. And it came in the room. Unless the breath of God comes into a church or an individual, a Christian, there is no spiritual life. No purpose. Nothing except fear. Afraid. It's the reason we need to have more of the Holy Spirit in us and on us and around us. We need to speak it. We need to live by it. We need to pray. We need to seek it. We need to fellowship with it. We need to know Him, and He needs to know us. Your choice. Your choice. We've got to have the breath of God in us. Now notice. God's creation, breath of God. God's creation in His church, breath of God. And you know what? The world, the flesh, man has tried to do away with the breath of God ever since. But let's go on. Back to Acts. Are y'all getting anything out of this? And there appeared unto them cloven tongues as of fire. And it set upon each of them cloven tongues as of fire. Now, when God called Moses, Sheila prophesied a little bit. How'd He call it? Out of a burning bush. Tell me about that burning bush. It wasn't consumed, it burned. It was on fire. I said this a couple of weeks ago and I'll say it again. What caused God to speak to Moses?
Moses
He turned aside to check it out. Wonder how many people have gone by and they saw it. Oh, a burning bush. It's a common coincidence over in the desert when a bush, dry bush gets hard enough, the spontaneous combustion, they catch fire and they burn. What isn't common? It doesn't. It's not consumed. Now, how do you know it's not consumed? You turn aside and look. You see, this move of the Spirit, people are going to go back turning to God, wanting to know Him, wanting to know His Word. He's going to become first above everything.
Amen.
Everything. Husband, wife, children, jobs. Everything. True church people are going to be searching out His Word because that's where life is. You put something else above Him and you've got something between your face and His face. People don't like to hear that. But it's true. We're moving into the final stages. And the bride is going to be worthy of the bridegroom. We're going to become like Him. Your choice. Your choice. What happened when Moses turned aside and he looked at it? God spoke to him out of the bush. And he said, take off thy shoes, because the ground you're standing on is holy. Wonder why so many people don't hear the voice of God. Maybe it's because of their parents. Out of all the people, Moses was chosen to lead them out of bondage. One person. Now later on, and I'm not going to go to all the scriptures, but I'm going to say this. Moses was tired and weary and all this stuff. And just worn out. And God told him to get 70 elders. And he called and he placed the 70 elders there. And then what did Moses do? Do you know?
Struck the rock.
Moses grieved at the commandment of God on the 70 elders. His breath and his wisdom went through. They received it. A couple others weren't supposed to receive it because they wanted it too. God gave it to them also. And when they were asked about it, Moses said, I wish you all would want it. See, this is what's happening. God's wanting this on all. But if you don't want it, you're not going to get it. You can sleep through church. You can sleep through this and that. Whatever. You won't get it. Now what happened when we go back to Pentecost? What happened to the fire? It landed on all of them up in the upper room. You would have thought it would have just gone on the apostles, the disciples. But all of them received it. Now this tells us something really personal. That God don't want one or two special people, three special people. He's looking for all who will receive the fire and live in the fire and be obedient to it. That means you and me. Now I want you to know something else. What would have happened if the early church hadn't gone out and started evangelizing? The 120 were the first fruits of the church, Pentecost. Had they died without evangelizing, that's where it would have ended. Don't you understand? It's all about fruits and harvest. That's the reason we go back to when this took place at the barley harvest. And the 120 were the first group of harvesters to bring the kingdom. That's what God's calling us to be as we step into this last great move of God, to be harvesters, fruit bearers, living for Him. Fire was on them. Now it says this. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit, or Holy Ghost, and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave utterance. They began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them the tongues to speak out. Why other tongues? What's God doing? Well, if you look at the Bible, you got to realize Jesus came is about what? What's Jesus' whole ministry?
Kingdom.
The kingdom of God. And what about the kingdom of God?
What is it for mankind? Redemption in restoring. Alright? Could it be that God is showing us something about His plan of redemption and what He's trying to do in the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Well, let's look. Turn with me to Genesis chapter 11. Genesis chapter 11.
Tower of Babel.
In Genesis chapter 11 and 10 and before, we've been going through some of the genealogies. Verse 1 says, the whole earth was one language and one speech. One language to one speech. Wherever they journeyed, they had one. Verse number 4 says, and they said, go to, let us build a city and a tower that may reach into the heavens. And let us make a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth. And the Lord came down, verse 5, to see the city and the tower that the children built. What's taking place here? What's really taking place? World in one language, trying to build a tower to make their own God. To make their own God. You see, that's what's happening all over the world. Everybody's trying to make their own God, and they're not Yehovah's. One world government, that's coming right now, all this stuff. Thank God we're not going to be a part of it. Do you understand what I'm saying? God saw that, and what did He do? He confused their language so that they could not do anything, and it restrained them that they couldn't understand one another's speech. And He thus scattered them around the world. And they called it the Tower of Babel. So the languages were Babel. Now let's look back at Acts chapter 2. Verse number 4 again. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling at Jerusalem Jews, devout men out of every nation under the heavens. Where were they? Jerusalem. Why? The feast. Being obedient to the word. And they were of different nationalities. And it says, out of all the nations. So every tongue and every nation around the world was represented in Jerusalem. All right. And Yehovah sent the Holy Spirit on those 120 people. And verse 6 says, and now when this was noised abroad, multitudes came together and were confounded because that every man heard them speak in his own language. So what did God do? He brought the people back to Him and spoke to them in their language, in other words, He's bringing back, restoring mankind to what it was intended to be before sin came in, before unbelief came in, before people started worshiping everything except Yehovah. Pentecost is a restorator, to restore. And this is one of the reasons the devil is afraid of the church understanding the power of Pentecost and the power of the tongue. and the power of God. Because he knows when we start stepping into that power and authority and understanding and walking in obedience, he's defeated.
Come on.
And that's the reason it's happening right now all over all this chaos, is because the church is beginning to hear and they're going to step into this power, and God's going to unite them in oneness in his power.
Yes.
It's the only hope the world has. He's bringing it back in our time.
Still in church.
We're the carrying of fire. The anointing.
My son.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Come on.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Now, notice this. I get worked up in a minute. Verse 7. And they were almost amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not these all that speak Galilean? And we hear every man in our own tongue where we went born. And then they go through and name. Verse 11. Cretes and Arabians, we do hear them speak in our tongue. Now this is important. What were they speaking?
Wonderful works of God.
The wonderful works of God. The wonderful work. They were glorified. You know, I got to say a couple of things. Sometimes we have to give testimony. And some people can take it and run on and run on and run on. But what is a testimony?
Wonderful works of God.
It's the wonderful works of God. It's the wonderful works of God. It's praising God for what he's done. What does God do and say he does to the praises?
Habits.
Comes down and inhabits them. You see, the world wants to shut us up praising God for what he's done. But it's the wonderful works of God. You and I want more of the power of God, more of the authority of God. We need to start praising him and giving him glory, the wonderful works of God. We need to tell people, look what God's doing, this and that and so forth. Glorify God, Yehovah. Because when it happens, things happen. They were in one accord, glorifying God. You want the power of God? You want to see God move in your life, in this church, in our family? Let's get in one accord and let's glorify God and let's step back and watch what God is doing and what God's going to do.
Come on.
Let's quit bellyaching and complaining and looking at all this stuff and look what he's doing. I tell you, this pandemic is bringing people to closer to Christ. What's going on right now is going to cause people, and it's causing people to look at different things. And there's only one healer, and his name is Jesus. Where it's emotional healer, physical healer, whatever. He's the only one that can heal this whole situation. And it's time we proclaim it and stand up and shout it to the housetops. It's time we quit looking at the negative things. Sheila just said this, and this is a good point. We all know what's set off all these fires and stuff is the knee on this young man's neck. The authority. And he says, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. Let me tell you something. That's like the government's neck on the church and the world. Do you know what happened in California? Do you know what happened Friday in California?
Yes.
Well, you better need to know it. The Supreme Court justice, supposed to be a conservative, Chief Justice. Who is he? Come on, you need to know it. John Roberts. He sided with the liberals and said they cannot open churches in California. He's just cursed California. And you're going to see the power of God come down on it. If I lived in California right now, I'd get the heck out. You think I'm serious? Let me tell you something. God's not playing. He's not playing. And sin and rebellion and these people that are playing games with God, it's not going to get it. He has chosen the devil's way rather than God's way. And it's like the devil trying to take the breath out of the church. It's time we shout it from the housetop.
Amen.
Oh, good, you cut the time off so I can't see. Praise the Lord. I like that. All right, now, we hear them, and what happens? Very important you see. What happens afterwards? Peter gets up and he preaches. And he begins to preach and he comes down the word. And I'm not going to go down all the word saying this was what was prophesied of Jonah. But you see, they knew enough to know the word. And they weren't rabbis. They had heard it, they had taught it, they had walked with Jesus. And they heard the word. You know, one of the things. And I'll just be honest. I'm appalled for how few people know the word. We need to know the word. Alright? And it goes on to say all these things. And in verse 21 it says, and it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It shall come to pass that whosoever invokes, the Greek says, invokes the name of the Lord, shall be saved. Now calling and invoking, to me, is a little different. You see, this is, we say, well, I call upon the name of the Lord. But when you invoke His authority, you invoke His word, you invoke His spirit, you invoke all of Him into this situation. You place Him where He should be, Lord of all. Alright? Now, and then He talks about Jesus. Alright? And then something else. He says, verse 38, Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized with you, everyone in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. You shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit. For it is a promise. It is a promise to you, and children, and to all that are afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall come. That's something. Now look at this. And when they had gladly received His word, they were baptized. They gladly received His word. Gladly received His word. The same day they were added unto them about 3,000 souls. First fruit, 120. 3,000 souls. Something else you need to be aware of without me going back and showing it to you. And Korah's rebellion. when Korah rebelled, Jew, priest, rebelled against the word, did it his way, argued against God, what happened?
He died. It was
swallowed. The earth opened up. His whole family and everything was swollen and went down in. 3,000 souls were lost. We start talking about restoration, redemption. Here we got the restoration of the 3,000 souls on Pentecost. Old book is about restoration. Old book is about restoration. Restored. Everything's going to be restored. Do you understand? Now, the next day, Peter and John, I've talked about this, but I've got to show you a couple of things here. Peter and John were going to the Temple Beautiful, or through the Gate Beautiful to the temple. And there was a man begging. And we know what happened. Peter looked upon him, saw that he had faith, and he said, "Silver and gold have I none. Such as I have, I give unto thee." And then he didn't pray over him or this and that. He reached down and grabbed him, jerked him up. Faith works. Faith has action. It just doesn't sit. It's time the church get back in action. It's time the church moved. Right? Now, what happened to Peter, John, the disciples? What happened to them? After that, what happened? Persecution came. They called them in. They took them in before the scribes and the Pharisees, and they ridiculed them, this and that. And what did they try to do?
Shut them up.
They wanted to shut them up. Same thing the world is wanting to do to the church and the Jews today. To shut us up. To shut us up. And Peter and John, verse number 8, chapter 4. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, "Ye rulers of people and elders of Israel." You see, it's not just enough to be filled with the Holy Ghost. We got to stay filled with the Holy Ghost. And you and I have got to function in the Holy Ghost on a daily basis.
Come
on. We don't need to be afraid of the world. We don't need to be afraid of anything. And they said these are ignorant men. And they told them to quit, beat them, and all this stuff. But you know, Peter gave them the word. This is what I want you to see. Verse 29. Turn with me to verse 29. Well, let's back at it. Verse 28. "For to do whatsoever they thy hand and thy counsel determine before to be done." And then he starts the prayer. He says, "And now, Lord, behold their threatenings, and grant unto thy service that with all boldness they may speak thy word." You want to know what your prayer for the church is, and your prayer for yourself? That you have the boldness to speak the truth of the word. I try my best, and I've always tried my best to speak with boldness the truth of the word of God in this church forever. Where it makes some people uncomfortable, that's fine. People want to be patted on the back. Say everything's all right. It is if you're right with God. It's not if you're not. And we need to have boldness to speak the truth. Then it goes on, by stretching forth thy hand to heal, and that thy signs and wonders would be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus.
Look at that.
Now, what is it? He's back with the believers. Didn't we start that taking place? And when they prayed, the place was shaken together where they were assembled, and they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they spoke the word with boldness. You see, you and I need to understand the reality of the Holy Ghost and His Spirit, and we need to have the boldness, but you've got to want it. You've got to ask for it. You've got to choose it. To speak the word for boldness, with boldness. They shook up the world because of their boldness. They didn't compromise. They shook up the world. We need to shake up our world with boldness and tell the truth. You see, broad is the way that leads to destruction. Narrow is the way that leads to eternal life. It's our choices. Our choices. Now, real quick, a couple more things. I want to show you. We spoke a little bit about Stephen. When Stephen was brought up before him, what did he do? He spoke the word with boldness. He didn't compromise. And then God opened up the heavens. And Stephen saw Jesus standing by the throne and declared what he had saw. And that drove the devil's children mad. And they journeyed out of the stone. He's being stoned. And he says to him, as I said earlier, Lord, don't lay this charge to them. I release them. I forgive them. Forgive them. Give them an opportunity to know them. Had Stephen not forgiven them, they would not have been able to be saved. And we would not have Paul, the greatest apostle that wrote one half. Think about that. Not at all. But because of the forgiveness, it's the reason you and I can't find God in the forgiveness. Sometimes it's hard to forgive and let go. We've still got to forgive and let go. Now, another thing. Going up here. Preaching. And he was preaching to the Gentiles. And as he was preaching, and he preached Jesus to them, the scripture says they believed. What happened? Nobody prayed, nobody says anything. Because the word was going out, the Holy Spirit flew. And all the Gentiles that were there who believed, all of them, spoke tongues, prophesied. What I'm telling you, I really believe, and Lord, check me if I'm wrong, that if we start with the boldness and go forth, we're going to see the Holy Spirit fall as we're speaking to people, and they're going to be humble, they're going to fall to their knees, they're going to want God, and they're going to be saved. And they're going to be baptized. We're moving in a new power of the Holy Spirit like we've never seen before. The church has got to go back to the church of Acts. When it speaks the word, when it says the word, when it does the word. Do you understand?
Amen.
We got whole denominations. They're like chapter 19. They do not even know there's any such thing as a purpose. And yet they think they're going to make it. It's time we take the fire that's on us. I want to pray that every person who wants it, you've got to want it, is going to get a retouch of the Holy Spirit and fire. And it's going to come down on you. And you're going to start walking in the new boldness like you never walked in. And power. And we're going to get the fruit. You see, God is going to protect us and provide through all this mess as we are obedient. If we're disobedient, He can't protect us. He can't provide for us. He can't give us the bread. He can't give us all this stuff because we're being rebellious and disobedient. But when we're obedient, He's obligated Himself through His Word to meet our needs and provide all these things. It's time we're stepping into a new relationship with the Holy Spirit. If you're baptized in the Holy Spirit, speak in tongues. If not, you need to be. It's your choice. You need to be. We need to pray for you if you want. You will receive it. I can tell you that. You will receive it. As the Lord told me many times, many, many years ago, He said, if they want it, if you take time to teach them, they'll receive it. Has anybody never been fed? And we're talking 40 years, and they've all been fed. None. And they all spoke in tongues. Because His tongues is a witness. You understand? You see, there's a boldness coming up like we've never seen before. And the power of the Lord. But it comes in a deep out of the deep. He wants to do it to you. He's not looking for no superstars. He's looking for all of us to be like the 120 in the upper room. We're the nobodies with the power under the fire and the anointing of God, because it's all His glory and it's all to Him. That's what God wants to do for you. This is what I want to do. I want to pray for you. Would you bow your head? I don't want anybody looking around. You're looking around. I'm looking around. I'll see you looking around. I'll call you out. Because you're looking around and stop the flow of God. Close your eyes. Now, if you want a new baptism or maybe a first-time baptism of the Holy Spirit, and God to touch you, I want you to stick both hands in. Why both hands? Because you want to receive. The disciples, the apostles, all receive new touches. So you can be baptized.